السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا
وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة وجاهد في الله حتى أتاه اليقين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. أما بعد، عباد الله، يقول المولى عز وجل في كتابه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. صدق الله العظيم. يا أحباب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، يأمرنا الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بالإكثار من الصلاة عليه يوم الجمعة، فأكثروا من الصلاة على حبيبكم المصطفى عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم advises us to make salah, to pray upon him, especially on Friday. Also the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, before we get into our topic, he actually in his first خطبة الجمعة in Medina, which was in Qiba, he stayed in Qiba a few days before he moved on to the Medina. He said very simple sentence: يا أيها الناس أحب الله من كل قلوبكم. O people, love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the bottom of your heart. So we repeat that advice to all of us. Ya ayyuha an-nas ahibbu Allah min kulli qulubikum. Love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the bottom of your heart. Not just for breathing His spirit in Adam, or asking the angels to make sujood to him, or enslaving the whole universe, but especially us, for blessing us with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for choosing us to be Muslims, and for the Quran, the light, the path to happiness in this life and the hereafter that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. Today, we want to tackle a real problem that our community face and the Muslim Ummah in general face. And it is a serious problem that I really want you to pay attention with your hearts and minds. We tend to disagree on many things. Matter of deen and matter of life. And it goes on from you put your hand here, there, you cover your head with a cap or not, into labeling each other and accusing each other of rebelliousness, fisq and fujur and whatnot, and even takfir. And we don't even stop there. We actually, sometime in our disagreements, tend to go and shed blood. Just last week in Pakistan, there was a school bus for girls going to a college who was bombed by a suicide bomber. Not only they stopped there, they had some armed men waiting at the hostel for those who survive and attacked the hostel and killed nurses and doctors and injured people. So many of us forget about Iraq, but you may know or not know that every month since the withdrawal of the US forces, the casualties, the number of people killed monthly has been 1,000 plus. No one even pay attention in the news. This is Muslim against Muslim killing each other. So today, I want to tackle the topic of differences between Muslims. Al-ikhtilaf bayn al-Muslimin. Is it natural to disagree? Is it normal to have difference in opinions or not? To what extent we take this disagreement? How to manifest this disagreement? How to act? Adab al-ikhtilaf, what manner should we behave when we are disagreeing amongst ourselves? Is disagreement is a positive thing or a negative thing? What is the limits of disagreements? This is the topic of our khutbah today. So in order to answer these very important questions and enlighten ourselves, so at least we become the first group of Muslims to behave differently, I'm going to walk you through very basic principles that I don't think any two of us would disagree on. And through these principles, you will find the answers, inshallah, very simple and very easily. First of all, we all know that our message, the message of Islam, is a message for all mankind, for all times and all places. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا كَافَّةً لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي نَزَّلَ الْفُرْقَانَ عَلَى عَبْدِهِ لِيَكُونَ لِلْعَالَمِينَ نَذِيرًا. So this is a message that has no boundaries in terms of race, language, country, population. It's a living message till the day of judgment. So for people to be able to live their life according to this message, there is an embedded flexibility and ease of implementation. يسر في التطبيق ومرونة. In order to function at different times and different places with different cultures. And this is not me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, yuridu. الله intention يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر. It is Allah intention for us to have an easy way to implement this amazing message, subhanallah, not to be living in hardship. If you take one of the most important pillars of Islam, Hajj, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made Hajj once in his lifetime. And when he was in Mina, the Sahaba kept asking him about the orders of manasik, of rituals. Can I sacrifice first? Can I do tawaf first? Can I shave my head first? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this important pillar of Islam, said what? If'al wala haraj. If'al wala haraj. If'al wala haraj. Do and there is no, don't have anything in your heart. You are fine. This is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One time, there was two sahaba who did not have wudu, and they made tayammum and they prayed. After they prayed, they found water. So one of them said, no, now there is water, it is still time. He made wudu and prayed again. The one who had tayammum said, I am fine, I prayed already, I don't need to do that. When they asked Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what did he reply? He said to the one who repeated the prayer, you know, you have been cautious, and it's a good thing. And he said to the one who did not repeat it, you have followed my sunnah, which is ease of implementation. This is the spirit of this religion. This is the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, there are things that doesn't change as time change or culture change or country change. We cannot pray 6 times instead of 5 times. We cannot fast in Sha'ban instead of Ramadan. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he fought the tribes that refused to pay zakah. It's very basic. I mean, there is so many ma'lumun min ad-dini bid-darura that not two Muslims would disagree on. And these things are not subject to negotiation or flexibility, or it is set clearly. Ayatun muhkamat. And we should not be disagreeing upon these things. However, there are so many other things, important things, that we don't have set rules in. And believe me, this is not me. You all know the story. In the last year of the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal ila al-Yaman. And he accompanied him, and he used to love Mu'adh, subhanallah. And he was telling him, لَعَلِّي لَا أَلْقَاكَ بَعْدَ عَامِ هَذَا. I may not see you again, ya Mu'adh. Then he asked him a few questions. How are you going to manage when you are far away in Yemen and judge and teach people? He said, Prophet, wallah, I follow the Quran. Very simple. So the Prophet ﷺ asked him, what if what you are looking for is not in the Quran? He said, I follow the sunnah of my beloved Prophet and teacher, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, what if it's not clearly stated in my sunnah? He said, أَشْتَهِدُ وَلَا أَلُوا. I do my best to follow the framework of this message. And the Prophet congratulated him for this brilliant answer. So in Islam, for example, we do not have dictated important things like the way we should be governed. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hinted to the Muslim that Abu Bakr should be their leader by appointing him to lead the prayer. Abu Bakr, on the other hand, specified a person to lead. Umar, on the other hand, radiallahu anhum ajma'in, picked 6 from which one to be a leader. So, for example, in matter of governance, you can see immediately in the time of the Prophet and his companions with his 3 systems of governance. When it comes to civic codes, the Prophet says, أنتو أعلموا بشؤوني دنياكم. As long as مقاصد الشريعة are fulfilled. What is مقاصد الشريعة? The goals of this message. This message is intended to develop a relationship between us and Allah. To protect الحفاظ على النفس العقل المال العرض. protection of your freedom of thinking, of your wealth and property, of your family. It also specifies relationship between humans based on justice, fairness, equality. These are maqasid al-sharia, and anything we do in that framework is acceptable according to the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We are ordered, by the way, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ, does this mean we're going to disagree or we'll always agree? Allah is talking to the believers. فَإِن, when you disagree in a matter, what to do? فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ, return to Allah and His message. وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ, when you disagree about something, what is the answer again? فَحُكْمُهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ, you return to Allah. The problem right now that we have in this ummah, we have so many of what I call أَنصَافُ الْمُتَعَلِّمِينَ, half scholars. They take one hadith from here or one hadith from there and they build the whole theory based on this. I'll give you an example. A young brother who used to come to the masjid where we pray in Irvine. He came one day and said, brother, why you are praying two times Jum'ah? This is bid'ah. He said, wallahi, we have a small masjid, is not big enough. وَسِلْعَةُ اللَّهِ رَائِجَةً, the Muslims are so many and we have traffic issues, so we pray two times. He said, I have the solution for you. I said, please tell me. He said, you have two floors. Women pray on the second floor and men pray on the first floor. Ask the women not to come to the Jum'ah prayer altogether and you solve your problem. صَلَاتُ الْمَرْءِ الْمَرْأَةِ فِي بَيْتِهَا خَيْرٍ وَفِي حُجْرَتِهَا, even in her room is better. So let them not ever come to the masjid, even for Jum'ah. And he took that hadith out of context as an example. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Holy Quran says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. We should not just grab a hadith from here or from there and declare scholarly and give fatwas and opinions. That's a very dangerous thing to do. This is iftira' ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa rasooli. And unless you are equipped to give fatwa, you should not give fatwa. And that's one of the problems we face today. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, yes, you will disagree. Yes, you will have difference in opinion. But you should not take it out of limit. As a matter of fact, Allah is warning us. Subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَنَازَعُوا فَتَفْشَلُوا وَتَذْهَبَ رِيحُكُمْ. Don't take the arguments or disagreements amongst you to a level where you fight one another, as this ummah is today, you weaken yourselves, and Allah take the sail out of your winds, the wind out of your sails. There is even more stern warning. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ فَرَّقُوا دِينَهُمْ وَكَانُوا شِيَعًا لَسْتَ مِنْهُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ. Those who take these differences and create divisions in deen between Muslims, you, Muhammad, has nothing to do with them. In the Day of Judgment, he will say, I do not know you. More warnings. وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ تَفَرَّقُوا وَاخْتَلَفُوا مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَهُمُ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ. Allah is telling us, don't be like the people of the book before you, where they took their disagreements to an extreme, and those who do so, Allah is promising them great punishment. وَالْعَيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. Another important point, brothers and sisters, and believe me, it seems like we have a problem. The more the person gets religious, the more it seems like it, you know, we want to make people's life miserable. I don't know what's the relationship sometimes, subhanAllah. It's lacking of understanding of the spirit of this deen. And let me explain to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. We did not leave anything outside this book. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. I have perfected this religion for you. I'm satisfied with Islam being your faith. So then this book is complete. But why it doesn't have every answer to every question? We don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not forgetful. وَالْعَيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيًّا. The answer is in the Quran and in the Sunnah. Why not everything is specified? It is mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَسْأَلُوا عَنْ أَشْيَاءَ إِن تُبْدَ لَكُمْ تَسُؤْكُمْ وَإِن تَسْأَلُوا عَنْهَا حِينَ يُنَزَّلُ الْقُرْآنُ تُبْدَ لَكُمْ عَفَى اللَّهُ عَنْهَا. Allah is teaching the Sahaba of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, don't nitpick and ask so many detailed questions because Allah will give answers. The more answers, the more specificity, the more hardship you will have and the generations after you will have. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left it open. Even Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam confirmed this in this hadith. إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَرَضَ فَرَائِدْ فَلَا تُضَيْعُوهَا. Allah prescribes certain things, do not transgress, do not waste it. وَحَدَّ حُدُودًا فَلَا تَعْتَدُوهَا. He prohibited certain things, don't cross the line. وَحَرَّمَ أَشْيَاءَ فَلَا تَنْتَهِكُوهَا. He made certain things prohibited, don't be rebellious and cross these lines. وَسَكَتَ عَنْ أَشْيَاءَ رَحْمَةً بِكُمْ مِنْ غَيْرِ نِسْيَانٍ فَلَا تَبْحَثُوا عَنْهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left many things unspecified as mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't try to narrow the wide, broad mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Sahaba understood this very well. And example that you all know, for example, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told the Sahaba, don't pray Asr until you reach the houses or the area of Bani Qurayza. Some of the Sahaba said they were going to miss Asr. No, he didn't mean that literally. They prayed before they reached there because Asr was going, they're going to miss Asr. Others followed the letter of the teaching of Muhammad and prayed Asr and Maghrib together in Bani Qurayza. When they asked the Prophet, they were both correct. This is the spirit. This is the teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The next point, along the same lines, we all have a chapter in the Quran called what? Al-Shura, the consultation. Can be consultation if we all agree on everything 100% of the time. What are we going to consult each other about? We're all agreeing. Why do we need consultation? This principle in Islam, it literally implies that we will disagree, and there is a blessing in the disagreement when we consult one another and come to conclusion. And wallahi, he teaches us that in business. You can be the most brilliant CEO, but they tell you there is no monopoly in intelligence. You need to consult with people and come up with the best opinion, and there is blessing always in two things. Before you do something, in istikhara and in istishara. This is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. By the way, the order to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to consult his companions came in very strange circumstances. It was the battle of Uhud. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to defend the Medina from within. The young people, they were zealous, and some of them felt that we don't want the kuffar to call us coward by staying where we are. We go out and meet them. Some of them missed Badr and they were eager to fight. So they pressured the Prophet ﷺ to go out. And they were defeated badly. And 70 of the best Sahaba were martyred, subhanAllah. Then what happened? The order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to Muhammad to do what? وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. Still consult with them because there is blessing in Shura. In general, as a principle. This is again أَمْرُهُمْ شُورَى بَيْنَهُمْ. Part of the spirit of this faith. We are different. We'll have difference in opinions. But if we integrate these differences in a constructive manner, we get the best answer. If we take this difference in opinions to divide and accuse each other and fight each other, then that is not the intention. One other problem we have, I was actually giving a lecture in Thousand Oaks. An American, white Caucasian lady, not Muslim, raised her hand and said, "Can I ask a question?" I said, "Please, go ahead."
Yeah.
She said, "Why anyone who make fun of your Prophet, alayhi salatu wassalam, you guys go on a killing rampage and kill whoever Western you find, or even kill each other as Muslims and set things on fire and..." Subhanallah. And I was, of course I answered, I'll tell you later what I answered, but do you know that Muhammad was insulted by Quraysh as a sorcerer, magician, liar? Do you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was insulted by Quraysh? Allah instructed us not to let asubbu, don't insult their statues, فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Now, did Sayyidina Muhammad set things in fire and just start an assassination campaign? Or he tried to teach people with patience and politeness? The Quran, in its language dealing with the kuffar, listen to how noble and how ruqi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says what? قُلْ لَا تُسْأَلُونَ عَمَّا أَجْرَمْنَا وَلَا نُسْأَلْ عَمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ. You are not asked for our crimes, and we are not asked for your deeds. Look at the fine language. Who's really the criminal, us or them? But the Quran and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ السَّيِّئَةِ فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. When Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a young man came to him, he said, "Prophet of Allah, I love sex. Why adultery is haram?" He didn't just lash him. He's saying that to the Prophet of Allah. He said, "Oh my nephew, would you like someone to do that with your mother?" "No." "Anyone to do that with your sister?" "No." "Anyone to do that with your daughter?" "No." He said, "The same people don't want that to be done to them." And he said, "I will never do it again, Prophet of Allah." This is the teaching of Muhammad. A man came to Harun al-Rashid once and said, "Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, inni nasihuk wa mughliz alayk. I'm going to be harsh in my criticism to you. So please be patient with me." Harun, before he started, Rashid said, "Don't even start. Because Allah sent someone who's better than you, Musa alayhi salam, to someone who's worse than me, Fir'aun alayhi la'natullah. And he told Musa and Harun, فَقُولَ لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرْ أَوْ يَخْشَى." Speak to him in soft language, he may soften his heart and listen. So, this is a teaching how to deal with non-believers. How about dealing with ourselves? You know, it teaches us in business, by the way, even if you disagree with someone and want to give him feedback, you start by telling him, "I appreciate about you such and such, but it will be great if you can improve in such and such." Wallahi, they took that us from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The nice language, the delicate approach to guiding people and teaching them. And we need to have that language whenever we disagree. We have what combine us. La ilaha illallah. We have Muhammad Rasulullah. We have the book of Quran. Isn't that enough to unite us? Musa and Harun, when Musa left to get the Torah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he left Harun in charge, they worshipped a cow made of gold. And when Harun, he advised him, قال إنما إلهك just give me a second. So when Musa told Harun, "Ukhlufni fi qawmi, you are my representative, wala tattaba sabila al-mufsidin." They start worshipping a cow. When Musa came and he was very angry at his brother for not leaving the people who worship the cow and taking the believers and separating them. So he took his brother beard and hair and start shaking it. So Harun pleads with him, يا ابن أمي لا تأخذ بلحيتي ولا برأسي إني خشيت أن تقول فرقت بين بني إسرائيل ولم ترقب قولي. The reason I stayed, I did not want to divide the children of Israel. I knew you're going to come back and straighten things up, and that's better than me dividing the children of Israel. We don't have such division among ourselves, subhanAllah. None of us worship a cow. None of us worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we need to have that tolerance for difference in opinions. As long as it's a matter of, you know, small things, not basic principles. Finally, the Prophet ﷺ tells us we need to be open-minded. The Prophet ﷺ tells us, الْحِكْمَةُ ضَالَّةُ الْمُؤْمِنِ أَنَّا وَجَدَهَا أَخَذَ بِهَا. And by the way, this open-mindedness, when the Ummah was at its best level, the scholars demonstrated open-mindedness. You may not know this or not, but Abi Hanifa, radiallahu anhu, he had a schoolmate of 30 students. And he used to consult in everything related to the Madhab al-Hanafi. And some of the opinions in that Madhab, he personally did not agree with. Al-Imam Malik, when the Khalifa, after he wrote Al-Muwatta, the Khalifa said, this is an amazing book. It was the first book written about the hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Khalifa did not want any other school of thought to be taught or implemented. He refused, because that's not the spirit of knowledgeable people. Shafi'i radiallahu anhu, he said, I never had a debate with someone or an argument in any matter and without me praying to Allah that the truth would come on his tongue, not on my tongue. This is the spirit. Ibn Hanbal, he used to not prescribe to saying Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in the imam, in the leading of the prayer, loudly. But he tells his student, when you go to Medina, the people of Medina do that, so do that so they like you. He had flexibility. But then we had followers who were rigid. To the point, a Shafi'i cannot marry from Hanbaliyya or what is this nonsense? And some people even went further. There is this guy, Al-Karhi, he actually went further and said, كل آية أو حديث يخالف ما عليه أصحابنا فهو مؤول أو منسوخ. This is the ta'assub that I'm talking about. Every ayah or hadith that disagree with our principles, it must have been mansukh, changed, or must be interpreted in the wrong way. We are right all the time. And that's what led to centuries of decline of this ummah. These are the basic principles that I really believe we need to prescribe to, we need to understand. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة على المصطفى اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ونبيك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. To conclude, disagreeing is natural. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ولا يزالون مختلفين ولذلك خلقهم. He didn't create, they will always be different, and he didn't create two human even with the same fingerprint. So having difference in opinion is a natural thing. But it is when we take it to an extreme, when we start insulting one another, accusing one another, fighting one another, then we have nothing to do with the message of this prophet or this deen. And that is where we need to learn. We need to learn adab al-ikhtilaf, the manners with which we disagree, adab al-hiwar, how to disagree with each other according to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and not let every problem divide us. I'm going to conclude with this story. And it's really a funny story, but it's a true story. Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu, 4 months after being a believer, a Muslim, the Prophet sent him as a leader to an army, of an army. And in that army, there was Abu Bakr and Umar. Imagine that. New Muslim, 4 months into Islam, leading an army. Soldiers in that army are Abu Bakr and Umar. And he later even sent support with Abi Ubaida ibn al-Jarrah, هذه الأمة. So most of the Sahaba are in that army. Come night time, it's freezing in the desert in the winter, and they used to have fire to warm themselves up. He said, no fire tonight. I'm the Amir, you all listen to me. Umar ibn al-Khattab being so vocal as you can expect, radiallahu anhu. Ya Umar, Ya Amr, لقد آذيت الناس, you're hurting people, let them turn on the fire. He said, لا والله, no one turn on the fire. Umar didn't take it, he went to Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, who's always a rock of belief, عليه رضوان الله. He said, Ya Umar, لو كان رسول الله يعلم أنك خير لهذه المهمة من عمر لبلاك إياه. If the Prophet knows you are better than عمر, he would have given you the job, listen to him. They wake up in the morning and it's Fajr time. And here is Amr ibn al-As making tayammum. There is water. He said, no, I need to take a shower, ghusl. And it's very cold, we all know that. And I'm not going to take a shower, I'm just going to make tayammum. But you cannot, we are teaching, you are a new Muslim. We are the one who know Islam for all these years. No. He insists on making tayammum and leading the prayer with tayammum. And the Sahaba are praying behind him grudgingly. Did Umar take half the army and say, I'm not playing with you, I'm not following you? No. He obeyed. After prayer, they start attacking the tribe they were sent to attack. And the tribe start running in every direction. And now it's time to collect the spoils. And they're about to start chasing them and collecting the spoils. And Amr ordered no one to follow them, no one collect any spoils, stay together. Don't chase anyone. What's the purpose? We are here to win and take spoils and hostages and whatnot. You follow my order. They did. Then they go back and they complain to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the Prophet gathered them in the masjid and asked Amr, why did you not let people turn on the fire? He said, Prophet, wallah, we are a few hundred people. We're attacking a tribe made of thousands of people. If they detect our presence through fire, they would prepare. And we have no chance. And the Prophet accepted his answer. Amr, why did you not make ghusl and only make tayammum, even though water was available? He said, Prophet, wallah, it was freezing. If I take a shower, they didn't have heated water at the time, I would have killed myself. Allah said, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بِأَنفُسِكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَ. So I made ijtihad, and the Prophet accepted his answer. Why didn't let them go and chase non-believers and collect the spoils? Again, we are few, and we are in foreign land. We do not know the ins and outs of this foreign land. And if we go in different direction and they regroup, we lose. But the discipline is what I'm trying to tell you here. We need to be disciplined, not to let disagreement divide us where we go in different directions. And mostly the youth, I tell them, you are our hope. We come with so much baggage as from different countries and different background. I tell the youth, you are our hope for a unified Muslim front, for enlightened Muslim front. Don't let all these cliches of, the being a Salafi, a Sufi, a mass, a this and this divide you. You all follow La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم إني داعي فأمنوا اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا اللهم اجمع شملنا اللهم احقن دماءنا اللهم أصلح ذات بين المسلمين اللهم اجعل جمعنا هذا جمعا مرحوما وتفرقنا من بعده تفرقا معصوما ولا تجعل من بيننا شقيا ولا محروما اللهم انصر عبيدك المستضعفين في كل مكان اللهم اغثنا بروح من عندك يا مغيث نستغيث برحمتك يا حي يا قيوم إنا مستضعفين فانصرنا إنا أذلاء فأعزنا إنا فقراء فأغننا. اللهم ارحم أمواتنا واشف مرضانا وفك أسرانا. اللهم اقض حاجة المحتاجين، فرج كرب المكروبين، ارفع الهم عن المهمومين، ارزق الفقراء والمساكين، اقض دين المدينين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على عبدك ونبيك ورسولك محمد وسلم تسليما كثيرا. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. وأقم الصلاة.